Church, it is a joy to see you all here this morning. When you came in, we hope that you received a worship guide that looks just like this. This has all the information you need to know about today's service and then also things that are coming up in the life of First Southern Baptist Church. We do want you to be aware that on Sunday, July 28th, we'll have a missionary speaker that will be joining us for Sunday school and for service. All of our Sunday school classes are invited to join us for a presentation in the gym during Sunday school. So please talk to your teachers, and teachers, please let us know if you and your class will be attending on that Sunday. Also, someone was generous enough to bring donuts for our church family today, so there are tons of donuts at a table outside in the Welcome Center. Please grab one on your way out. Just someone being generous and loving our church, so please take part in that as well. But if you are visiting with us here this morning, we are glad to have you. We are praying for you. We are praying that you experience the love of God today, that you experience the love and the fellowship that we have here at First Southern. And we would love to connect with you and your family. And one way we do that is through a connection card that looks just like this. If you would look at the seat in front of you, if you would take that card and fill that out, we would greatly appreciate that. You can leave that card in your chair where it's at, or you can bring it out to the Welcome Center, or you can drop it off in the tithes and offerings box as well. We will have some volunteers at the Welcome Center. If you have any questions, please meet us out there. We would love to answer any questions that you have. We would love to connect with you and see how we might be able to pray for you in whatever walk of life you are coming in. So please visit us out there. If you are visiting, we have a gift for you as well, just to say thank you for joining us. So please stop by and see us after service today. But thank you for joining us. Brother John Worth is going to come and read our scripture this morning.
Good morning, everyone. My name is John Worth, like Jason said. I'm one of the deacons here at First Southern. I'm on team number one. Jeff Brasher is our captain, and we get a little help from Ansel Goodman. If you would, turn with me this morning to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. While you're turning there, if you truly want to do good work for the Lord, start out each day by reading God's Word. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip His people to do every good work. Let us pray. Father God, we're so thankful for Your Word, thankful for the opportunity that we can come to Your house today to learn more about Your Word. Father, I pray that You'll be with Brother David today as he brings us Your message. I pray that our eyes and ears will be opened and our hearts softened by Your Word. Father, I pray that as we go our separate ways, that we can always be good witnesses for You. Lord, I just praise Your holy name. Thank You for the many blessings that You give each and every one of us. We pray that You'll continue to bless us. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
When life gets you down and you feel more broken than whole, when the wounds go deeper than words and you can't tell a soul, I may not know what you're going through, may not can take that high mountain move, But one thing I found that I really want you to know. If it matters to you, it matters to the Master. He wants to share the burdens you bear, give you peace when your world gets shattered. If it's your greatest joy, or your deepest pain, or you're really needing an answer, if it matters to you, it matters to the Master. Friend, do you think the maker and giver of life is far too busy to care about your trouble and strife? He sees the sparrow that falls to the ground, and he hears the tears that don't make a sound. If you only knew how precious you are in his sight. If it matters to you, it matters to the Master. He wants to share the burdens you bear. Whisper peace when your world gets shattered. If it's your greatest joy, or your deepest pain, or you're really needing an answer, if it matters to you, it matters to the Master. If it's your greatest joy, or your deepest pain, or you're really needing an answer, if it matters to you, it doesn't only matter to you. If it matters to you, it matters to the Master.
All right. Thank you, Susan, for sharing with us today. Let's stand together. We have an opportunity to sing to God. And according to the scriptures, he is listening and he is waiting to hear from you. So let's sing this song together.
All my life you have been free. The book of James, in the third chapter, it speaks that we use bits in horses' mouths to guide them, that our tongue is like a ship's rudder, such a small part of the ship, but can direct the directions of an entire ship, that our tongue can be like a little fire that starts a raging conflagration, destroy hundreds and thousands of acres. In the book of Matthew chapter 5, Jesus Christ speaks at the Sermon on the Mount and says that ye are the salt of the earth. If the salt has lost its flavor, what use is it? We're directed by God's word that says this. This is in Colossians chapter 4, verse 6. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. We do not understand the power of the words that we speak until we look at them in the light of Scripture and see the impact that our words can make on other individuals. Make sure that we use every word as an opportunity to communicate God's word to people's hearts. I wrote this message 2 weeks ago, and I pray that it sinks deep into our hearts, that we might see the opportunity that God has handed us this day to communicate God's grace to those who are around us. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we come before you recognizing that we are in your hands, that, Lord, you are sovereign, that, Lord, you control the events of mankind to the smallest details. And Lord, may we recognize that, Lord, you work in our lives today. The world is in the state of confusion right now. But Lord, you have handed believers the truth. You have handed us the words to say to a confused world. May we recognize the opportunity that is before us and diligently obey you. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, let's stand again if you will.
Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb.
Father, we know your voice. You say that your sheep will know your voice, and God, we know you. God, we have our own kind of wilderness today and our own kind of challenges. But God, you give us your written word so that we can learn to hear your spoken word as you speak to us, as you tell our hearts we are not alone. But God, today, we have set aside this time to know your voice more, to hear your voice. Above all of our fears, above all of our uncertainties, with all the voices that are inside of us and all the voices that come at us from outside, we pray that you would be the loudest voice. Even then, God, that when you're not the loudest, you would be the whisper that we can hear above all the others. And you can do this, God. We know you. Speak to us today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Turn with me in your copy of God's Word to the book of Jonah, in the very first chapter of the book of Jonah, in the very first chapter. I have two competing emotions. One has come natural in my life. The other has been developed over many years of trial and experience. One, I've mentioned to you before that I, in one sense, am very empathetic. I do not understand watching people who become hurt. And the years ago, there was a TV show called Home Funniest Videos or something like that, and many times it was people being hurt, and they would have some laugh track and people be laughing at that, and I would cringe and always wonder what sadistic people laugh at other people being hurt. I never understood that show. It just didn't make sense to me whatsoever. And that's been something that I just have always had. Even when someone's got a flat tire on the side of the road, my heart goes out, because I've been there so many times myself, you know, I just hurt for other people who are going through difficulties and trials. Now, I've mentioned that to you before, but there's another aspect that I'm not so proud of, but it is something that I have developed in my life. And that is, I have such a focused mind that many times I am oblivious of what is going around me. Now, I can be so engrossed in a book and I get lost in a world of reading and just get into concentration and imagining, if it's a story type, imagining the story, or if it's in theology and doctrine, I'm trying to see how that plugs into outlines of the Bible, and my mind becomes so passionate about such things. Things can be going on around me and I'm absolutely oblivious of it. As a matter of fact, you can ask my wife many a time. She'll say, David, you know, and somewhere along about the sixth or seventh time, I'll think, ooh, somebody's talking to me, you know, and I'll come out of that, you know. It even goes beyond that. One of the first years, we moved out on Redbrush Road out past Alcoa, and it was 4th of July, and I was reading. Go figure. And there was an explosion. I mean, you need to understand this. It was an explosion. Someone set off a stick of dynamite, okay, and it rocked the houses through our neighborhood. And Kim came in and said, did you hear that? And I said, yeah, I heard something. And I went back to my reading. You know, that's how engrossed I can be involved in something. And things around me can literally become oblivious to me. Now, I'm not saying that because I'm proud of that. I mean, sometimes there's things that I should be paying attention to, and I am just not hearing it, seeing it, or even aware that it is going on around me. Now, we live in a culture that has a natural tendency that says that we should pay attention to those around us, that it is rude if we do not acknowledge people in some way. Now, that is a Christian principle, by the way. That is something that comes straight out of the Bible. When God says that we are to love Him with all of our heart, mind, and soul, we need to understand that is something that we are to do. But then Jesus Christ takes from Leviticus a very similar statement and puts it on the same level of importance and says, love your neighbor as yourself. Now, the thing is, there is a contradiction that we have in our lives sometimes. Because we are called of God to acknowledge people, to love people, and to witness to people. And that is the exact opposite of ignoring people. We are called to be God's witnesses. And when we choose to ignore, then we are committing sin. With that in mind, I ask you to turn with me to Jonah, for we find some powerful lessons in these verses that I wish to read to you today. My translation puts it this way, Jonah chapter 1, I'm beginning to read at verse 4. I'm going to read down through verse 6, and it says this. But the Lord sent out a great wind into the sea, and there was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. Then the mariners were afraid and cried, every man unto his God, and cast forth the wares that were in the ship into the sea to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep. So the shipmaster came to him and said unto him, what meanest thou, O sleeper? Arise, call upon thy God, if so be that God will think upon us that we perish not. Now we understand the circumstances because we've been talking about this already for a couple of weeks. Jonah is the preacher of God. We would refer to him in biblical terms as the prophet of God. He has been called of God to go to the capital city of Assyria, which was called Nineveh. He has refused to do that. He has, in turn, said, I want to find the farthest place that I can go on earth that was known at that time, which would have been the farthest reaches of Spain towards the west, and that was where the location of Tarshish is thought to believe in that particular day. So he has gone as far as he can away from the direction of going to the city that God has called him to. Jonah here is trying to ignore God. I hope that we understand today as believers, you cannot ignore God. God does not leave us alone. He has tried to ignore God. He has tried to ignore the Ninevites. Now, he didn't like the Ninevites. There was already an animosity that was in his heart because Nineveh and the Assyrians had attacked Israel and many were killed because of the conflict that was going on there. We know that Assyria eventually conquers that northern kingdom called Israel. Only the southern kingdom of Judah was saved from that invasion. Jonah is facing those kind of people and he does not like them, so he is trying to ignore them. Now, most of us, when we think about the book of Jonah, runs there. And we began to talk about Nineveh and Jonah. But today, I'm not talking about Nineveh. Today, I'm talking about some sailors on a ship. And Jonah is in their midst. He is right in the middle of all that's going on. And what we find here is that Jonah is ignoring the lostness that is around him in one of the biggest crises of their lives. And Jonah just does not care. He is asleep in the bottom of this ship. Now listen, I know that we talk about it's unkind to be rude to individuals, and we talk about that in a circumstance where we should always show kindness, which is absolutely true. But we're considering something today that goes far beyond just being rude to individuals. That there is a world in crisis, and that we need to speak the very hope that lies within us to that world that is in crisis. What we see is some examples here that I want us to bear witness to in our own lives and begin to find out what ship are we on, what sailors are we around, and what are we doing about the crisis that is raining down around us. So I got some points. It's on the back of your worship guide if you'd like to follow along with these points. Number one is simply this: God is the one who sends the storm. Look at verse 4. It cannot be mistaken here. This cannot be twisted and tried to put some other kind of blame or some natural circumstance upon this particular situation. We can't talk about how the winds and the waves interact and how storms rip across an ocean or a sea. And we cannot try to say this is just a natural occurrence in any way, shape, or form. Verse 4 says, the Lord sent out the great wind into the sea. God is the one who is initiating this. This is something that God has determined to do. Now, most of the time, we think about storms, and we don't think about God being a part of those things whatsoever. We sort of exempt God out of our thinking as responsible for the things that happen around us. But here, we cannot miss this single point, that God is the one who is sending this storm. Now, we can go through the entire scriptures and begin to see a connection with storms and God over and over again. We can go back to the book of Genesis and recognize God is the one who flooded planet Earth. that's a big storm. We can think about the other kinds of storms and disasters that came about. We can think about Job, where a tornado come and ripped down the house that his sons were in, and all of them were killed because of that storm. And we can begin to recognize that God is the one who allows such things to happen, and then in turn, like verse 4, makes it happen. So we see that God is the author of this storm. Jesus Christ in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7, he concludes the Sermon on the Mount. He talks about a man who builds his house on a rock. He talks about another man who builds his house on the sand. And then Jesus Christ says the storms come. It rains and tears on both of those houses. It tears on the house built on the rock. It tears upon the house that is built upon the sand. Jesus identifies and says the one on the rock stood. The one on the sand fell flat. But recognize Jesus saying the storm came on both individuals. Many times as Christians, we are tempted to think that, but we're on God's side, why would he allow a storm to come? It's a good question. The fault here is when we begin to think that because we're on God's side, or we profess Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we declare ourselves a Christian, we faithfully attend church, we regularly study our Bible, we are regularly in prayer, then God should make it easy on us. That is nowhere in the Bible. The health and wealth preacher today will declare to you all over the internet, all over, they have massive congregations, they fill up massive auditoriums, telling you if you just have enough faith, you'll be rich and healthy forever. Yet those guys still die also. You see, they're not preaching the Bible, because the Bible tells us that the storms come into our lives. As a matter of fact, if you were to go and just take some time and study the little book called 2 Timothy, you'll begin to recognize where Paul is writing to his protege, Timothy. And he says these words that many of us Christians just love to read over and just sort of just skip that part and just find something better that's more appealing to our likes and our dislikes. And so these verses don't hang into our minds often. But here it is where Paul says these words: for those who live godly shall suffer persecution. Now, we don't like those kinds of verses, do we? We tend to not want to dwell upon those kinds of things. It's something that we don't want to have to think about or even maybe deal with. But God is the one who sends the storms. The question only is, how do we face the storms? Sometimes God is teaching us endurance. Sometimes God is teaching us correction. Sometimes God is just teaching, showing us who he is and what he is doing in our lives. God has lessons for every single one of us. God is directing somewhere, somehow in your life today. If you do not recognize that, it's because you are just trying to ignore him, because he is there and he is trying to do something in your life. Now, I'm not saying obviously that it's always easy. Storms in our lives never are. Sometimes they are devastating. I can assure you what your pastor does every time he faces a storm. The absolute first thought that comes to my mind is this: God, have I sinned? I don't know if that's your first thought, but that's your pastor's first thought. God, where have I messed up? I want to repent. I want to get things right. Whatever it is, I want to confess it. and I want to be right with you. That's where your pastor starts when the storms hit his life. It might be a good place for you to start also. Now, I recognize that that's not only the reason why we face storms. There are other reasons. There are times when we face things and you're going to say, well, did I mess up? Have I sinned, God? And God says, nope. In Job's case, it was not sin. But the storms came upon his life. But there is a hope. There is a promise. There is a good thing here that I hope we hold on to in our lives. And that is this. God never walks away from us. God never says, I give up on you. I'm just going to forget about you. He doesn't do this with Jonah. Jonah is doing the exact opposite of what God has commanded him to do. And God is chasing him down, going in the opposite direction of what he has been commanded to do. God is never going to say, that's it. I give up on you. You are not worth it anymore. God will never say that. And he has demonstrated that he will give his best, his son Jesus Christ, for you. I hope we see that even when the storms come, that we stop and say, God, thank you, because you're with me here in the midst of the storm. I hope we recognize that God many, many times is right in the midst of the storms that we face in life. The second thing I want you to see is also found in verse 4, and that is sin affects others. It gets repeated in our society and our culture today, and it is so sickening unto me. It is something that churns inside my heart when I hear individuals say this, but it's repeated over and over again. It's these words: my actions are my own, and as long as I don't hurt anybody else, I should be able just to do whatever I want to do. There's a fallacy in that thinking. It is a fault. It is a lie. It is a deception for any of us to ever think that we can sin alone. To be able to think that our sin has no effect on anyone that is around us is a satanic lie. And there are those who are deluded by this lie to think my sin will never affect anyone around me. Our sin always affects those around us. It might be that our sin affects our spouse. Our sin might affect our children. Our sin might affect our friends. Our sin may affect other family members. Our sin affects our work associates. Our sin affects other students who are around us. As our personalities are affected by sin, thereby other people's lives are affected by our sin also. Think about some sailors upon a ship this morning, since we have just read about them. Here are some sailors upon this ship. They're working on that ship. They understand storms. They understand winds. They're experienced sailors. They know exactly what to do when the sea becomes so vicious that you have to do something or you're going to sink. We are told here in verse 4 that they do the most common thing that every person on a ship who knows anything about ships, you do this in a storm that looks like it's going to capsize and throw your boat over, and that is you lighten the ship. Therefore, they threw the cargo of the ship overboard. Why does a person do that? They don't do that in case something bad might happen. It's when they are already convinced something bad's going to happen. And And we have to lighten the ship. Their whole purpose for being on that ocean at that particular time was to deliver goods from one location across the waters to deliver them at another location. Somebody paid for those goods. They were all completely lost because they were thrown into the ocean. The sailors are terrified. That is a huge indication. Now, when I was pastoring in Northwest Alabama, our deacons would often take fishing trips down to Gulf Shores, a little bit south of Mobile, Alabama. And so we go to the coast there. We go on deep sea fishing trips. We did it often, at least once or twice a year, sometimes three and four times a year. One time we took a two-day trip, 4 hours in the evening, and the next day we was going to spend 8 hours out in the Gulf of Mexico, and we were going to do an all-day fishing trip. Went out there. Most everybody got seasick. I did. Had never been seasick for my life, but 8 hours out there was a little bit longer than what I had prepared for, and so I got sick. Most of the deacons were sick also. I still outfish every one of them. And then a storm came up. And because I was sick, I was laying down on a mat down in the cabin underneath the deck. And I was laying down there, and a deacon come up and said, "Do you know what's going up on the deck?" And I said, "Well, it feels like a storm is raging on." He said, "Oh, yes, oh, yes. The waves are crashing over the front of the boat. There's two pilot chairs. One is downstairs underneath. There's a second that's up on the high beam." And so the captain was up there on the high beam. The water was crashing over all of that. And the little ship was going up and down. It was pretty vicious. And he said, "Don't you care that we're in the midst of a storm?" Well, two thoughts came to my mind. The second one I voiced to him. The first one was this: "I'm too sick to care. If we go down, I'll feel better." I mean, that's really kind of how I felt. The second thought was this, and I did say it out loud, and I said, "Look up there. Look up there on the high pilot. What do you see?" He said, "I see the captain." And I said, "Does he look scared?" And my deacon looked at me and said, "He looks like he's just Sunday reading the newspaper, you know?" I said, "When he gets scared, I'll be scared. He's not scared, I'm not scared." And so I went back to sleep. This was not that case. We're reading about Jonah, who is on a ship where the experienced sailors are terrified because they think they're going to die. And they begin to call out to their gods. Why? Why were they being terrified? Why did they lose the cargo? Why is all this happening? Why is there a storm? Because there's one man in the bottom of that boat who is sinning against Almighty God, and everyone around him is suffering for it. The third point I want you to see, number 5, verse 5 tells us this case, and that is sleeping in the storm. Now, most of the time, we would categorize someone who's able to sleep in the middle of a storm as a good quality. I know some individuals who can sleep in the middle of storms. I mean, you just, you know, their snoring should just sort of, you know, drown out anything going on in life, you know. I've been in some preachers' meetings at the state convention, and, that's true. It truly is. Now, normally we think sleeping in the midst of a storm is a good quality. One of the things that really astounds me about Jesus is when he is in the boat with the 12 disciples, they're crossing the Galilean Sea, and a storm comes up. They, remember, Peter and Andrew and James and John were fishermen who knew this sea very well. They're terrified. They think they're going to die. And we look and see Jesus asleep in the bottom of the boat. Now, I'm just astounded by that. Think how wonderful quality it is to sleep in the midst of the storm. But this is something different. In Jonah, we find Jonah asleep. There is a hardness of sin in our world today that can literally tune out the cries of those who are in agony and desperation of their lives. And many, maybe even most Christians, just turn deaf ears to it. Here, God screams at us, "Do you not care?" We live in the United States of America. We have some of the most flagrant and ungodly things going on in our nation that cannot even be found in other nations. Do you understand that United States of America houses the greatest number of individuals abusing children sexually than any other nation on this planet? That United States of America is the number one offender of children than any other nation in the planet. Mexico is the number one supplier of child abusing in sexual ways than any other nation, and the United States of America is the number one consumer of that horror. The question is, do we care? You see, it's easy to say that somebody else's problem, that someone else's fault. Do we turn deaf ears to those who are being abused because of their poor circumstances and they cannot make a living and do things that they should be doing? Do we even care as long as our bank accounts are full and we're paying our bills? Then we should just feel okay, right? Where individuals who, because of lack of knowledge or some kind of ignorance, they're taking advantage of. People are scamming them and taking what dab of money they have in the first place. Now let me supersede all of that with a stronger statement. There are people dying and going to hell every minute on this planet. Do we care? Or are we just going to turn a deaf ear to the cries of the world around us? Jonah is sleeping in the bottom of a boat when he should have been on his knees repenting and calling out to God because people's lives were at stake around him and he did not care. How far will God go to get our attention, folks? Would he dare send a storm to America to wake up the sleeping Jonas in the bottom of the boat? Which leads me to point number four. We find it in verse 6. Unbelievers are confused. The world is confused. We often tend to blame the lost for being lost by saying, oh, they have hardened hearts and therefore they will not listen to the gospel of Jesus Christ. That may be the case in some ways. That may be an accurate description in some ways. But I want to call your attention today to this passage of Scripture, because here Jonah was the preacher in the bottom of the boat, and there were those around him calling out, help us understand. They were crying out, we don't understand what's going on. And what does Jonah do? He lays asleep in the bottom of the boat, keeping his mouth shut. These are not the hated Ninevites that he despises so well. These were just sailors trying to transport him from one port unto the next. They're seeking a solution to the horror that they are facing. They're asking the question that the world is asking today: why is this going on? Who's going to answer them? Who is going to speak up and say, I have a word to speak to you that God wants you to know about? These are people asking, seeking, begging for someone to tell them something that would give them hope in the circumstances that they find themselves in. You know what they're asking? Look here at verse 6 again. They're asking, what God should we pray to? Who should we put our faith in? What should we believe? And Jonah is asleep. We have an opportunity before us today, because I assure you, on this Sunday, in the United States of America, people are asking, what in the world is going on? And we have an opportunity, because they're facing things they do not understand, and they're asking the same questions. What should we believe? What hope do we have? What kind of answers would supply in our hearts? Where can we find hope? What should we believe in? And the Christians are sinning when we remain silent and do not tell them the truth of God's word, that Jesus has come to die on the cross for your sins. He took your sins and placed them on his own life to pay what was duly the punishment we deserve, so that we might be acceptable to a holy, righteous God. And through faith, we can turn our hearts and our lives over to Jesus Christ. There is an answer, folks. And we ought to be telling people that answer. The only question is, are we asleep? Are we ignoring those who are around us? Which leads me to point number 5. It's also found in verse 6. The captain comes down to the bottom of the ship. If a storm's going on, that's not where you find the captain. Whenever there's chaos and so sailors are looking for some direction of what to do now, they look to the captain. He's not there. Where is the captain? He has gone down to the bottom of the ship. Now, folks, there's only one explanation that I can think of that would drive the captain down there. And that's this: he knows he is facing something that is supernatural. That God, and he knows this because he's asking Jonah, why are you sleeping? Get up and pray to your God. He knows this is something supernatural. He knows this is something spiritual. This is not something that they have ever experienced before. This is not something that you can just ignore. There is some reason they are in the dilemma that they are in. And so he runs down to Jonah and has to waken him. Do you read verse 6 with me and see some sarcastic innuendo in this? I mean, he's saying, what in the world are you doing asleep? We're going down. We're going to die. Now, that's pretty obvious. And so he is calling out to Jonah. No one sleeps when a ship is going down. Notice what this captain says. This is a pagan captain believing in a false god, doesn't believe the truth of God's word, does not know Jehovah God, does not know the scriptures of the Old Testament. He don't know who to believe in, what to believe in. But how wisdom comes out of the mouth of babes. It is a pagan Go unto a believer in Jehovah God, who is the prophet of God. What does the captain tell Jonah to do? See it in verse 6? Get up and pray. You know, the lost world who doesn't believe in God many times calls out for people to pray in the midst of chaos. Pray. Pray. And here are the Christians who are supposed to know this stuff, who are supposed to know what to do, are listening to unbelievers call out and tell us, pray. You know, even unbelievers know what they should be doing. That is to pray, call upon God. The captain says, your God. He doesn't even know the God that Jonah is God of. He didn't know which God. He said, whatever God you got, you better start praying to him. Sounds odd to us, I'm sure, but yet this is exactly what he is doing. And I confess to you today that this unbelieving world is asking you and me, who do you call on? When they call it chaos reigns, when the storms arise, when the confusion is everywhere, who do you call on? There are those that you're going to go to work with tomorrow and going to see throughout this week. And they're looking at your life. They're looking at you. Oh, maybe they've heard you go to church on Sunday. Maybe they've heard you confess yourself a believer in Jesus Christ. Maybe they know that you hold some position at First Southern Baptist Church. You're a teacher, a deacon, a trustee. Maybe you're something else. And they know that about you. So they're going to look at you tomorrow morning. And they're going to think this. They may never verbalize it to you, but they're thinking this. Where's your hope? What do you believe in? What are you praying? How are you dealing with the chaos in the world today? What are you doing about it? They may never say a word to you about that, but I can assure you they're watching. So how do we respond to that? How do we respond to a world that's asking, what am I supposed to believe in? What God am I supposed to believe in? What am I supposed to place my hope in? How do I endure through the chaos that I'm facing this morning? Are the unbelieving world calling on First Southern Baptist Church, its pastor and its congregation, to pray? I hope that has come to your mind long before it's been suggested to you from anyone else. I hope that we hear the Holy Spirit of God saying, yeah, pray. But I hope we hear the Holy Spirit saying things like this. You know that person you have been fearful to bring up the name of Jesus with because they've said such vile and vitriolic hatred towards believers? Might you speak to them the name of Jesus tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock? Might you say, I want to tell you that this world's in God's hands. At times it doesn't look like that, but God's in control. God is working. And he orchestrates events and situations in our lives so that we would have prime opportunities to tell other people about Jesus Christ and why we have the hope that lies within us. Might we hear the call of God today? I'm going to ask you to bow your heads. Maybe today you're saying, well, I showed up today because I don't know this God you're talking about and why Jesus Christ died on the cross and what all that stuff is about. And you might be saying today, I know I'm a sinner. I know I've done wrong in my life. Big sins, little sins, intermediate sins, however you want to classify your sins, you recognize them. They're sins. And they're sins against a holy, righteous God. And that God has spoken to your heart today, knowing that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. And in your heart, you want to say, God, come into my heart, forgive me of my sins. I want you to be Lord and Savior of my life. The message that should be shared on a sinking ship is our hope is in God. Jesus Christ has secured that for us. Maybe today you're already a believer, and today you're saying, I just want to know how to respond to all that's going on, preacher. Well, I hope you heard that today. I hope it's not mistaken. I hope it's not hidden that we should be telling other people about Jesus Christ, because he is the hope. He is the hope of the world, not just the United States, not just for bad people. He is the hope of everyone, and everyone needs to hear about Jesus Christ. No matter who they are or what they believe in right now, they need to hear about Jesus. Might God lay upon our hearts this week, as people begin to talk about stuff all week long, and the news goes on and on and on about events, you know what's on everybody's mind right now. Then I pray God would prompt you to say, let me tell you where my hope lies. It lies in Jesus Christ. And I pray that God would cause those circumstances to come about all week long. Long for you and me. Let us be ready to share with them how to be saved in Jesus Christ. Maybe God has spoken to you about something else today that I've not even alluded to. God's Spirit works in mysterious ways, and so whatever God says to you today, you be obedient to Him. You do what God wants you to right now in this invitation time. Let us lift our heads. Let's stand and sing. If God leads, you come. Close in a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you so much that we can turn to you in all the circumstances of our life. And Lord, we recognize that's not always the negative things. Lord, we turn to you when there's great joy. We turn to you when there's blessings upon our life. We turn to you when we hear good news and people are doing well. And we just praise you for that because you orchestrate those things also. But Lord, we know today that's on our minds and our hearts that we're thinking about our nation. We're thinking about someone who was killed yesterday. We're thinking about threats. We're thinking about politics. We're thinking about presidential elections. And we're thinking about all those kinds of things. But Lord, we know there's nothing that goes on that you're not aware of, that you're not working in and through. We thank you for that, Lord. The Lord, we can be your witnesses in this world. May we be faithful to that cause. Lord, we know at times it's not easy. At times it is threatening. But Lord, help us always to have words filled with grace and seasoned with salt, so that when people hear the grace of God and that they have a thirst for understanding more of the hope that lies within us, Lord, we thank you that we can be prepared to share with other individuals. Lord, help us to be faithful in that task this entire week. Thank you for bringing us to your house today. Lord, help us to encourage and pray for one another. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.